Greetings, two-stroke enthusiasts. Back onto this topic in our series. Last few videos has been on how to design an expansion chamber and the equations that go with it, according to the equations given by Professor Gordon Blair. But last one, we went into basic measuring of the exhaust port area and the reason we do it, and converting the arc width of a measurement that you've taken off paper into a chordal width. This one's going to get into the radii. Now, to measure the radius of each corner, if you're going to measure it physically up the bore, what you can do is just get a couple of drill bits and get the right size drill bit, and one that's too small that rocks around in the corner isn't right. And then just go up size until you get one that fits snugly in there. And then the diameter of your drill bit, half that diameter, is your radius. Do the same for each corner. Once you've got the radius, then we can use the equation to actually subtract it, each radius, from the whole area of the rectangle. So we've calculated the area of the rectangle, which is again height times width, keeping in mind that area is like a window pane. It's in two-dimensional, so it's if these are in millimeters, it's millimeters squared. So what we do is calculate the rectangle first, and then we've got to subtract each radius, the area of each radius. So we've got to work out the area of each radius, and we use this equation: radius times radius minus pi times radius divided by 4. And that will give you an area in square millimetres, if it's all in millimetres. And then you take that number and subtract it from the area of the whole rectangle. And you do the same for each radius. So that's how you subtract the radius from it. And the next part of it is, if we've got odd-shaped ports, we might have a port like this, and we might have a bridge in the middle and another port facing the other way, shaped like that. We might have a port shaped like this with a rounded end, or a port with an angled end. Generally, what we can do with these is we can just simply divide them up. So we divide them up into rectangles, and we do the area calculation for each rectangle as we would have done, as described just before and in the previous video. So in this one, we've got a rectangle down here. We just mark a line here and across here, which divides the two in between them. So here we've got three radii to measure. Now, this one is an inside radius, and this one is an inside radius. So those have got to be subtracted from the total area of the rectangle. But this is an outside radius to the rectangle. It's on the outside. Okay, so we've got to add that to the area. So we've got to add the radius of this to the area and subtract these two. One is calculate the rectangle and subtract these three inside radii from there. And then the two total areas, add them together, and you've got the total area of that port. Again, be sure to convert all the width measurements. If you've done it on paper, in other words, the flat arc width being the curve around the port, you've got to convert it to a straight line. So you've got to convert all the width measurements to chordal width. Okay, you don't have to on the height, because of course that's not curved in that direction, it's curved around the bore. And I'll just give you a brief demonstration of what difference that makes. So we'll just jump to our software in the port calculator. I just have to open that window. You see the chordal width is quite different to the flat width, whereas if we go down to 20 millimetres for the flat width of the port, 19.47, if we go down to 10, it gets less and less, okay, 9.93. So that's just to show you the difference when we're measuring the chordal width from the flat width. Now the next one is if you've got a port with a rounded port like this, again, split it into a rectangle. So take a direct measurement from the measure the height, okay, and then measure in from the edge, all right, half the height. So you've got the radius here is the same all the way around, and then draw a line through there, and then the rest of it is your rectangle. So calculate your rectangle, subtract the two radii out of the rectangle, and then take this one and treat it as a semicircle. Okay, so if we know the semicircle, we know the circle, the diameter of the whole circle, we can calculate an area of a whole circle, and then we can just divide that by two, slice it in half. So once we know the area of a circle, and we halve that to give us our semicircle, then we know the area of the semicircle, we can add it to the area we've calculated for the actual rest of the port in the rectangle. We can do pretty much the same thing here, okay? We can take a line through where the sloping part actually begins, and then we can treat this as a rectangle itself, subtract the two radii there. We can treat this one as a full rectangle without a slope, and we can subtract the two radii from it, and then we can split it in two. So we diagonally divide it in two. Because remember, once we convert it to area, then it's flat, two-dimensional area measurement. An ellipse is a little bit different, but basically similar calculation to the circle. We basically just get the width divided by two, which is kind of like a radius, and height, same. So we're effectually getting the radius times radius. It's just that there's two different figures, so they're given as width and height. But again, if the port is an oval-shaped port, you've got to take that width and you've got to calculate it into a chordal width. So that would be chordal width divided by 2 times height divided by 2 to get the total true area of the ellipse in the port. In some cases, you might use a piece of graph paper to actually measure, put the paper in the bore and scribe it, whatever, to mark it. And then you're going to mark that out or trace that out onto some graph paper. So you're going to actually use the graph, the little squares, millimeter squares be they, and count up the number of millimeter square millimeters you've got in the graph paper that encompass your port area that you've got. Even when you do that, you've still got to correct it for the chordal width factor here, as explained before. Now, if you've got software and the software accepts the flat arc widths, and you can put that in and it'll correct it, all well and good. But we're not using software in this case, so we've got to actually do it ourselves. So it's not difficult at all. Just count up all your squares or parts of the squares that you count up to get your total area of the port area that you've got on your piece of paper. And also measure the flat arc width of the port. So measure it from here across to here and get a total width. All right. So we're calling that our arc width, which is the curved arc width here from the paper, but laid out flat. Okay. Divide the total area by the measured paper port arc width to get a height. So you see what we're going to do is convert it backwards into two dimensions. So we've got area from graphs, but we want to get it, turn it back into a width and a height. So we take the width that we've measured, total area divided by that paper arc width will give us a height. So now we can take our paper arc width that we've measured across here and convert it into a chordal width using the equation. And then once we've corrected the chordal width and got a straight line width across there, then we can just convert it back into area. Because we've got our height here, so we take our height here, multiply it by our chordal width that we've got out of the equation, and that gives us an area back. And that area in the chordal correction should be slightly smaller than the original area that you calculated. And that area figure is the one that we go back and we use for doing our original calculation. Once we've got our area, we want to turn it into a diameter for the sake of the expansion chamber and move on to dimensioning the pipe using the formulas that Professor Gordon Blair gave us and work from there. So we'll get back to more interesting videos soon. These ones are not particularly interesting. They're more just a function of anyone who wants to build a pipe. And I've had a lot of people actually email me and whatnot and say, you know, can you help me get the right dimensions for a pipe? And basically this is how to do it for their purposes, because they want to actually use the information to do something with. And that's kind of the overall objective of these videos, is to give you information that you can actually go out and use. So we're getting into more general interesting stuff, a bit more interesting stuff after this is done. But next we're going to get through the pipe dimensions. And at the moment these videos are not getting many views because YouTube algorithm's playing funny things, and I've looked at my stats, these videos aren't getting suggested as normal ones do. So please share the videos, and we'll see you next week. Bye for now.